All right, we're back to talk about not so much going global here, but to going local. The globalized economy has created, in fact, some gross inefficiencies and hidden costs when it comes to producing goods, conducting trade, and creating jobs. It's tremendously profitable to find the lowest cost slave farm in China to make an iPhone, but it's not clear that that's ultimately the best thing for the people of this earth. And a new documentary called The Economics of Happiness focuses on ways to fix the broken system that we have now and why moving toward a more localized model may be the answer.
The truth is, what we've developed today is a system that could not be more wasteful. We have tuna fish caught on the east coast of America, flown to Japan, processed, flown back to America and sold to consumers. We have English apples flown to South Africa to be waxed, flown back again to be sold to consumers. The whole process involves incredible quantities of waste.
Filmmaker Helena Norberg-Hodge joins us now, also the founder of the International Society for Ecology and Culture. And Helena, we welcome you. How do we come to this place where we're shipping apples around the world to package them?
We came to it by not looking at the theories which in the 1700s might have made sense, but which today have become absurd. I found there's just this enormous gap between economic thinking and policy making and what's happening in the real world on the ground around the world.
What are the implications of the interconnectedness, the digital universe, and the capacity for such an incredibly responsive and adaptable universe on a local level that is only plausible in the context of modern technology, and yet all of the government's policies seem to try to prevent that very adaptation and local economic development?
The implications are that we should be looking at using those technologies of communication for information exchange and collaboration to solve our serious social and environmental problems. But instead, they are primarily used for an expansionist, totally unstable, as we've seen with the financial system. We've seen that this speed and scale of trade using those tools is disastrous for people on both sides of the divide between global north and global south, for labor as well as for the environment. So we really need to re-examine from a big picture point of view what is actually happening. Right. The current forms of communication, unfortunately, are not giving us the time and the space for a more systemic understanding of what is really going on.
And what do you think is the most important thing for us to understand?
The most important thing to understand is that there are actually simple policy steps that could be implemented right now that would reduce unemployment and pollution simultaneously. It's a real win-win strategy that is essential right now for our survival, but a whole series of myths keep us rushing in the wrong direction. And the tragedy is that this is polarizing societies worldwide, right, left. You know, so many small business people and small farmers and so on think the problem is the left and their emphasis on labor unions, their emphasis on environmental protection, protecting animals. They are not looking at the economic system, which inevitably is going to lead to unemployment and to increased poverty. The other thing I want to add is it's so important that we realize that the unemployment that's being created in the U.S. as the jobs fly over to China is actually being mirrored in China. Millions of people are being pushed away from smaller businesses on the land, smaller towns, into Beijing, which now in effect has 60 million people. And the end result there too is mass unemployment. So we so desperately need a more global understanding. And what's so good about it is that it can, where it's beginning to happen, it's bringing people together from right and left, different races, different ethnic groups. When they start rebuilding the local economic fabric, start supporting the local businesses, you also get this social healing. So it's a real win-win strategy, and I really hope people will take it seriously to look at the film.
The greatest barrier, it would seem, is there's one school of thought that looked to use technology to create a hyper-efficient, hyper-output system that is incredibly rigid, not adaptable in any way, but technology used explicitly for efficiency. For instance, in the financial system, if we did the financial system that Bob Rubin and Bill Clinton gave us, we ended up with this incredibly high output, and any small variance results in 20 or $30 trillion being sucked out of the system because it's so rigid. The other version of technology is not to emphasize hyper efficiency for a few people's benefit, what that is incredibly rigid, but to emphasize hyper adaptability, which is also possible with that technology, but threatens the profits of those who send the vast fortunes that they make to our politicians. 40% of all political donations come from the banking sector. The next biggest donor is from the healthcare monopolies. So how are politicians going to do the right thing to release the adaptive potential of technology and forfeit the rhetoric of rigid efficiency that lines their pockets?
I estimate that less than 1% of the global population is actually actively promoting the deregulation of finance and trade. And we've got to see they're completely linked. The trade in water, importing and exporting live animals, exactly the same products are being imported and exported in larger and larger quantities, the main reason for global warming and CO2 emissions. But this same process, when people wake up to it, the 99% who are simply not aware of what's happening, when they wake up, there will be no doubt what our policymakers will have to do. As it turns out, even in this 1% of the global population, which is about 60 million, there is a huge amount of ignorance. I feel motivated to try to get these ideas out because I have been dealing with policymakers, economists across the globe. And I find that almost universally, the biggest problem is ignorance because we don't have a clear systemic view of what's actually going on. And the speed and the scale, and particularly the blind faith in more and more technology and more global trade, that's what's driving us in the wrong direction. Let's remember that every business right now is actually being subsidized, aided and abetted to use more technology and energy rather than employing people. So we have deep in the foundations of our economic system an assumption that made sense 500 years ago, or rather it was 300 years ago that it was formulated. It made sense then, hundreds of years ago. Today we've got to reassess. On a crowded planet, it does not make sense to continue subsidizing energy and technology and dumping people.
I could not agree more. Helena Norberg-Hodge, all the best with your film, the organization, the International Society for Ecology and Culture. Congratulations on the movie. Jobs, of course, our main focus here on the DR show.